notwithstanding. Now let's look at a couple of Satan's tactics when it comes to recognizing the position and holiness of God. How holy do you suppose God the Father would have his people hold his name? Well, let's go back to God the Father and his earthly people for just a moment here, and let's take a look. Return with me here to a kingdom passage found in Psalms chapter 111, verse 9. He sent redemption unto his people, in this case being the nation Israel. He hath commanded his covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, forever. Note it here, holy and reverend is his name. Now, we're going to be looking at what's in a name today, but holy and reverend is his name. You see, Israel, one of their, the charge that God gave them was to proclaim God's name, to make his name great among the Gentiles. All the capacity resident in that name, all the capacity resident, we could say, within the within his being L-O-R-D, capitalized every letter. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. We'll be talking about that also today. You recall the reverence called for in the prayer so commonly called the Lord's Prayer. Actually, it was a prayer given to the disciples for the tribulation period, not a prayer for this age at all. But notice the reverence that God intended to be associated with his position as the true God of the universe. What were the disciples to pray? Our Father who art in heaven, next phrase, hallowed be thy name, or holy be thy name. You see, at least some of the Old Testament Jews had a healthy respect for God's name and for his position. It's illustrated in the tradition they used when they copied the Holy Writ. The scribes, or as they were later called, copyists, were especially chosen men. We've talked about this in previous studies, who were given the awesome responsibility, really, of before the advent of the printing press and modern-day computers and page maker and all the other things we have, desktop computers, to copy the scripture. They copy it down by taking their writing instrument and faithfully copying the autographs. And they did so over and over and over again. It was a tedious, painstaking process to do this. And it had to be done in a little at a time in a very primitive way in our manner of thinking. These men had a respect for the name of God. And our respect that really few of us, I think, know today. It said that when they came to write the name of God, the Hebrew YHWH, you see it there? According to tradition, they had to take a ceremonial bath whenever they came across those letters in copying. Not just a little sprinkling ceremony in this case, not a baptism in that respect. They had to bathe their entire body because they were approaching such a holy name. That's how they looked at this. And we're also told that when they came to the name of God, they were not to use a quill that had just been freshly dipped in the dye. Because that freshly dipped writing instrument just may be dripping a bit. And you know, when it comes to jots and tittles, you don't want any drops changing a word around. And that might cause a blemish or a smear or some sort on that holy name. A lot of care and reverence was associated with God's name. In fact, they had such a reverence for that name that they scrupulously avoided any mention of it at all. They would not let it pass from their lips. Instead, they substituted another word, and usually that was the word Adonai, from the word Eden, the plural Eden, meaning Lord, Lord, Lord. Speaking of, it was a matter of ownership with that title. Usually the word Adonai, YHWH, would later be pronounced Yahweh or Jehovah, as we would say today, and that's probably not the way they would say it. But according to Unger, the strong possibility is that the name Jehovah was anciently pronounced Yahweh. And Jehovah was considered to be the most personal and holy aspect of the name of God. You see, when the Jews came to God's name in their public readings, they actually refused to pronounce it. They felt it was so holy that it was inappropriate to even frame that word in their lips. And so when they came to YHWH, they just said the word Adonai, as we said, or the word Lord. Lord, 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 master, owner, being the idea behind that word Lord. And it's interesting that this tradition has even come down to us in our day in the translation of our Bible. Have you ever noticed when you're reading, especially the what would be called the Old Testament scriptures, sometimes the word Lord is found in all capital letters? Have you come across that? In other times, the word Lord's found in, with just the L capitalized, the other letters being in the lowercase. That's because of this very tradition we've been talking about. Back when they translated the Bible, they wanted to be very careful when they used the name YHWH in their translation. And they assumed the same tradition. And actually, when you have all capital letters in your Bible for the word Lord, that is the Hebrew Yahweh. It's the Hebrew word Jehovah. It's the YHWH. And when you have the smaller case, then it's the word Adonai. The translators chose to translate the word Adonai with the lowercase letters capitalizing only the initial letter. And that's exactly what the Jews did when they read. They came to the word YHWH, and they read A-D-O-N-A-I, Adonai, because they had so much respect for the position, the holy name of God. Of course, the word God is used today with no thought whatever of who it is being referenced. God could mean any number of things to any number of people today. How many people just say, oh God, or oh my God? It's just a matter of everyday speech. If Paul is right in Philippians chapter 3, verse 19, and we know that he is, having been inspired by the Holy Spirit to write what he wrote, most folks who use the expression, oh my God, might just as well say, oh my belly. Now, I'll show you this. What did Paul say in Philippians 3? Now we're jumping ahead in our home text, Philippians. What did he say in Philippians 3:18? For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. They are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. So you see, even when it comes to God the Father, the YHWH of Hebrew Scripture, Jehovah, we could say, he's spoken of today in empty and in totally meaningless ways.